The 4-1 record that the Phoenix Suns have obtained over the first five games of the 2020/2021 NBA season is actually by far the best season or start to the season that the Phoenix Suns have had since they drafted Devin Booker in 2015. Not only is the 4-1 record the best record that they've had, but defensively, this team is, as a unit, by far the best defensive unit that they've had since they drafted Devin Booker. And not only that, they're one of the best defensive teams in the NBA. Only two of the five Phoenix Suns opponents have made 10 or more three-point field goals in the five games that the Phoenix Suns have played. One of them was this last game against the Utah Jazz on December 31st, and the other one was the first of two games against the Sacramento Kings. As an average, the Phoenix Suns are actually only giving up about 7.8 three-point field goals allowed per game, which actually ranks first in the NBA, and right now they rank second in the NBA in terms of opponent three-point percentage over the first five games. The number of 7.8 three-point field goals allowed per game this year is about four less than last year when they were at about 11.6 allowed per game. They still were in eighth in terms of the rest of the rankings in the NBA, but subtracting four three-point field goals in a game is the difference of about 9 to 12 points per game, which, as we have already seen, with the Phoenix Suns only allowing 98 points per game, we can already see that allowing less three-point field goals is probably something that they were targeting on the defensive side of the ball this offseason, and it's already paying dividends for the team. Now, it cannot go understated what Monty Williams and James Jones have done for this team in terms of putting a team together and putting minutes together for this team. There's been a big uptick in minutes for guys like Mikal Bridges and Cameron Payne from last year, and we've seen already Dario Saric, who is not really a defensive guy in his own right, has had a little bit of a minutes down swing for him. They got rid of guys like Kelly Oubre and Ricky Rubio, who are not very good defensively, and they replaced them with guys like Javon Carter, Chris Paul. They added Jay Crowder in the offseason as well. So we can see an obvious switch from a team that was more offensive sided to a team that not only is very good defensively, but still keeps a little bit of that offensive firepower as well. And speaking of offensive firepower, the best thing that the Phoenix Suns did from last year to this year is they were able to keep a lot of players who are good three-point shooters, not just good three-point shooters, but very good three-point shooters. Replacing Kelly Oubre with Jay Crowder, we've seen so far Kelly Oubre has really struggled with the Golden State Warriors, not just shooting the ball, but just putting points on the board in general. Replacing him with Jay Crowder in the starting lineup has already paid dividends for the team. He's a very good upgrade in terms of the defensive side of the ball over Kelly Oubre. And we saw him last year in the bubble with the Miami Heat, how well he could shoot the ball, how often he could go on a shooting rampage for the Miami Heat. And he's a guy that, paired with Devin Booker and Chris Paul and DeAndre Ayton, is a guy that's not afraid to shoot shots, which, when you're with Devin Booker and you're with Chris Paul, you need two or three guys like Jay Crowder, like a Cameron Johnson off the bench, like a DeAndre Ayton in the starting lineup, who are not afraid to take shots and are used to taking a lot of shots in a game. And like I said, this is already proving to pay big dividends for the team. Now, to me, the biggest revelation for the Phoenix Suns this year is the major improvement that we've seen already out of 24-year-old forward Mikal Bridges. The 24-year-old out of Villanova has already seen a big uptick in his minutes as he's playing the most minutes per game as he ever has at 33.2 per game. His shooting percentages are a little bit out of a fantasy as he's shooting about 50% from the three on five attempts per game and about 56% from the field in general on about 10 attempts per game. Now, even though it has been a very big improvement for Mikal Bridges on the offensive side of the ball, I think the thing that is what made him a first-round pick in the first place was the defensive side of the ball. And I will go out on a limb right now and say I think Mikal Bridges by the end of the year will be in firm running for most improved player. Not only that, I think he could be in the running for a first-team all-defensive, you know, selection. With a steal and a block and a half per game, statistically he has been very well. And when you throw in the fact that he has a 99 defensive rating, it just goes to show that Mikal Bridges not only is affecting his team positively on the offensive side of the ball, but paired with that defensive side of the ball ability that he has, I think he will be in the running for most improved player by the end of the year. And even though it seems that DeAndre Ayton might not live up to that number one overall pick that he received in 2018, especially when you compare it to players like Luka Doncic, Trae Young, and many others that were in that draft class, I think if he's slotted in with his team as the third, if not maybe even fourth option on the team, I think he's going to flourish in that role as he already has averaged about a double-double throughout the season with 10 points and 11 rebounds. He's still been a solid contributor on the defensive side of the ball as well, getting about a block and a half per game and being able to steal the ball as well from other centers. So I think DeAndre Ayton, even though he hasn't taken that taking that meteoric leap that many first round and first overall picks that we've seen in the past few years. I think if he, again, is in that role as the third or fourth best option for the offense, he will flourish in that role, and it will make the Phoenix Suns even better. Now, the two superstars for this team in Devin Booker and Chris Paul, even though many people might say that it's not off to the greatest of starts statistically for these guys, what Chris Paul has been able to add as a complete facilitating god on the offensive side of the ball, and what Devin Booker has been able to attribute in terms of his scoring ability, I think it's been a perfect matchup for this team. Devin Booker has averaged about 20 points per game on a very good shooting percentage at 48.1%. And even though his 3-point percentage is at 32, he still has played very well this season. He's turned the ball over a lot this year with about 5 turnovers per game. However, mixing him with Chris Paul, who is going to take a load off of Devin Booker in terms of the facilitating, it's been a very good matchup between those guys. And I think that, you know, with the role players that they have, with guys like Mikal Bridges and Jay Crowder, DeAndre Ayton, guys off the bench like Cam Johnson, Javon Carter, and Cameron Payne, this team is not only offensively very gifted with their top guys like Devin Booker and Chris Paul, but defensively, they're stout at pretty much every single position. I don't think you really can necessarily target any single guy on this defensive side of the ball, and if you are, it might be Devin Booker. But even then, he's taken a big step forward with his improvements on the defensive side of the ball. And as a 24-year-old guard, he's been one of the best guards in the NBA, not only this year, but for the past few seasons. And now that he actually has a very good team around him, not only will this team be vying for a top spot in the West, but they very well could push the Lakers to, if they end up facing them in the playoffs, to a 7-game series and possibly even winning that series in, you know, against LA. With the incredible talent both on the offensive and defensive side of the ball, and one of the league's best coaches in Monty Williams, like I said, there's no reason that this team can't beat the Lakers in the playoffs, even if they don't come against the Lakers. I think that they could take any team in a 5-6-game series pretty easily, actually. And yeah, there really is no reason that this team not only can compete for the Western Conference, but compete for an NBA title. With all that being said, that's going to be the video for me. I hope you all enjoyed it. If you did, make sure you leave a like. If you didn't, make sure you leave a dislike. Any feedback from you all at this point is much appreciated. If you're new here, make sure you hit subscribe. If you are one of my returning 60 subscribers, I appreciate you clicking onto the video so much. And yeah, I'll see you all in the next video. Peace.